بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Usama. And today is going to be part one about Al-Jinn, or from the long journey to learning about Al-Jinn. Who are Al-Jinn? What is Al-Jinn? Why are they called Al-Jinn? Al-Shaytan, what's the relationship between Al-Shaytan, Iblis? And so there are so many questions these days about these creatures that do exist. They coexist on this earth with us. And people, the ins, meaning you and I, pay special interest to these creatures. Do Al-Jinn actually, can they inhabit my and your body? Can they take control of our body just like a driver takes control of a car and drive us wherever they want to? Can the jinn make us do what it is we don't want to do? If that is the case, when we die, can we use them as excuse? Has Al-Quran spoken about this kind of things in Al-Quran? Has Iblis given us any ideas about who he is, what he is here for, what it is that he wants to do, what his purpose? Can we see Al-Jinn at all in this life? If we do, what is their shape? What do they look like? These and gazillions of other questions are out there. And because of this lack of knowledge. Now, someone might say, we do have a lot. The internet, my brothers, is type www.teachmesomething.com and you get whatever you look for. Yet ignorance is widely spread, because out there on the internet, you can find a lot of good knowledge, and tons of it is a nonsense knowledge. If you listen to it, you'll end up in big, deep trouble with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So here we are going to look at the issue of Al-Jinn and Al-Shayateen from the very, very start until our time today. So bi-idhnillah, we will understand this issue fully and deeply and dearly, so that we can protect ourselves against Al-Shaytan and his offspring, and we can also spread good knowledge with people, because this is, as I said earlier on, when ignorance sets in, na'udhu billah, there are lots of wrong beliefs that go there. Al-Jinn have throughout history been categorized into two categories. So people, or should I say people towards Al-Jinn, have always been in two categories. Those who completely deny them, and those who say they exist. And obviously we know that Al-Jinn exists, because anyone who will deny the existence of Al-Jinn will disbelieve, is no longer a Muslim, even if they pray and do. Why? Because Allah has spoken about them in Al-Quran. And the Sunnah, the authentic Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, has spoken about certain creatures that are called Al-Jinn. Is their name Al-Jinn? Well, we will see what their real name is and why they are called Al-Jinn. So the jinn have always been part of the human belief, and either you can name them differently or Al-Jinn. For example, people call them spirits, others call them ghosts, malevolent souls, metaphysics, and they even call them aliens, and so on and so forth. So they are given different names, but the outcome product is one. We are all talking about those that we call Al-Jinn. In this day and age where technology and science have dominated most of the world, mankind still don't know much about what really goes on into the unseen realm of the spirit or the jinn. We can't see the jinn with microscopes, we can't see them with lasers, we can't see them at all. Just like we can't see oxygen, the air that you breathe it in, but you can't see it, can you now? Can you use a microscope to see it, can you? We can't, it's just out there, and only Allah knows. You know, it's a gas, but then again, we don't know the specifics of this guy as the looks, the colors and things like that. So it's colorless, we don't see it, we just take advantage of it. So this paper here will cover everything that needs to be known about the world of Al-Jinn. As I said, who they are, what they are, what do they eat, drink, do they sleep, do they die, how do they get born, and all these things, I will cover them in this year. So the first thing that I want to cover at this stage here is to understand who came first. Did mankind come first or the jinn come first? As by the saying of Imam Ibn Kathir عليه رحمة الله in his book البداية والنهاية, the beginning and the end عليه رحمة الله. What he meant when he wrote his book is really he wrote a book of history. Starting from the beginning and the end is the happening of the hour and all that goes, and he documented historically events that took place in his time, and obviously since he's dead for 8 centuries now, we cannot add to that book, but he documented whatever it was in his era, and that's what it is. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and so does Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhum, mentioned that al-jinn was before Adam alayhi salam by 2000 years. So al-jinn lived on earth for 2000 years, and so they were just like us, people who lived, creatures who lived on earth for 2000 years. But at one point they oppressed each other, they transgressed against each other, they spilled the blood and they committed murders and everything. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down upon them an army of angels, and the whole of the earth was cleansed. Some of these shayateen and jinn were expelled to the islands in the oceans. So now, from that time until when Allah orders them, al-jinn, the most predominant place where al-jinn live is in the oceans. That's why our scholars, they prohibit taking to the oceans without a reason. Don't go on a cruise in the oceans, because every single day, as in Sahih Muslim, a shaitan puts his throne on water and calls for a general gathering of all his jinn and shaitan. Every jinn and shaitan on earth meets him on that throne on water. Just make sure you don't end up in that vicinity when that meeting is happening. So this one, by authenticated this chain of narrators to Abdullah ibn Umar and Abdullah ibn Abbas, is an authentic one through Imam Ibn Kathir alayhi rahmatullah. It's worth mentioning that none of the Sahaba attributed these sayings to a Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's a piece of information that is there to comfort us, to give us some sense as to what has happened. But definitely al-jinn have existed before us on earth, and they have caused a mischief, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an army, and that's how al-shaytan ended up in the seventh heaven. Al-shaytan, when he was on earth before, he was a very pious person. He used to call and make da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a righteous person. So when that battle happened and he got honored by Allah, not to be murdered by the other jinn that the angels went down to destroy, he was taken to the heaven. So here is 2000. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hijr says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, ayah 27, ayah 27, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْجَانَّ خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ مِنْ نَارِ السَّمُومِ. And al-jann we created before from an-nar as-samum, and I will explain that later on. So our contact with al-jinn started with the creation of our father Adam alayhi salam. But here is a question. Why did al-shaytan specifically refuse to prostrate to our father and to us by fellowship? Why? Well, this is what happened actually. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered al-malaika, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. And we want to put 1,000 lions under ard in that ayah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summoned all the angels and said to them, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. I am to create a khalifa on earth. So from day one, Allah has decided that Adam alayhi salam will live on earth. What happened later on was the reason why Adam alayhi salam was sent on earth, to honor the first command that Adam will be a person that's going to live on earth. It's not that Allah has created Adam for Jannah and then things changed. No, Allah specifically created Adam so that he inhabits earth. What happened between him and Hawa and eating from the tree, that was the reason to make the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take place. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not call him. He did not say, إني جاعل في الأرض رجل. Allah did not mention man. I'm not going to put, he didn't say, I am going to create a man on earth. No. إني جاعل في الأرض خليفة. And the خليفة has got two meanings. It's a successor. For example, you succeed somebody else. You, the offspring, when you get married and you leave your child, you say خلفة. So he left behind him. So Allah is saying that he is going to leave on earth or create on earth a creature that is not, it's not only one single entity, but he will keep reproducing. And also Khalifa, like Khalifa of Rasulullah, again, a successor, you could be in the offspring, physique, or in duty. So this prime minister is Khalifa, is the successor of the previous minister, and so on and so forth. So this is how it happens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called us by our function, that we are successes. Al-Malaika, having seen what al-Jinn have done, they said, Ya Allah, is this new creature going to be at the end like those who were before? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun, and I know that which you do not know. So why did Adam, why did al-Shaytan carry that animosity? Why did he decide that, let's say, I'm not going to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam? But before going to that, what does the name al-Jinn mean? Al-Jinn opposed to al-Ins. The thing that opposes al-Ins is al-Jinn. These two, al-Jinn is anything that you don't see. Al-Jannah is because we don't see it. And al-jinan, it's gardens, because as soon as you walk into a forest or in a garden that has a lot of trees, trees cover each other. So what is at the end of that garden, you cannot see. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in about Ibrahim alayhi salam, فَلَمَّا جَنَّ عَلَيْهِ اللَّيْلِ, and when the night covered everything on Ibrahim. So al-jinn is the unseen, is those we cannot see. The opposite of al-jinn is the seen. And thus al-insi min al-istinas. So humans, you hear footsteps and you can't see who is walking behind you or coming towards you. You get scared because you don't have something that you can lean on. But if you see another human, you feel comfort. You feel that that is another human walking there. So al-jinn means those we do not see. That's what it means. In Al-Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Musa alayhi salam, وَأَلْقِ عَصَاكَ فَلَمَّا رَأَهَا تَهْتَزُّ كَأَنَّهَا جَانٌ وَلَّا مُدْبِرًا وَلَمْ يُعَقِّبْ. Al-jan here is a hayya, is a snake that moves fast. And al-jinn and al-jan are of the same root, and also it means something that moves very, very fast. So to understand the animosity between Iblis and Adam, let me take you on a trip on how Adam alayhi salam was created, so that you understand why the animosity and why a shaitan decided to go against us. The first thing that happens is there are certain elements, the pre-creation. The pre-creation is the land and water. Those things are not part of Adam alayhi salam. They are the beginning of what was to form Adam alayhi salam. عن أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله خلق آدم من قبضة قبضها من جميع الأرض أو من قبضة قبضها من جميع الأرض فجاء بنو آدم على قدر الأرض فجاء منهم الأحمر والأبيض والأسود وبين ذلك والسهل والحزن والخبيث والطيب. الحديث رواه الإمام الترمذي وقال حديث حسن صحيح وراه أيضا الإمام أحمد وأبو داود والحاكم والبيهقي والحديث صحيح. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم in a hadith reported by أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه said that Allah سبحانه وتعالى created Adam from قبضة. القبضة and قبضة are of the same root, but they differ in the meaning. قبضة meaning a grip, your own grip. And in this sense here, it is Allah who took the grip from the earth in a way that befits His Majesty. And القبضة is if he commanded an angel, Jibreel alayhi salam, to go and grab a grip from land and bring it over. So if it is قبضة, then it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who did it. If it is قبضة, it is Allah who commanded an angel to go and get it. It really is not that much of an importance how, but the most important thing is that قبضة or that grip of land was the source of our creation. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took, as you know all, the land and mixed it with water. So that is, and then soon as you mix water with the land, what do you get? You get the mud. Things start getting muddy. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah As-Sajdah, ayah number 7, الَّذِي أَحْسَنَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَهُ وَبَدَأَ خَلْقَ الْإِنسَانِ مِنْ طَيْنٍ. My brothers and sisters, Al-Quran is an intelligent book that talks to intelligent people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks a little bit when he spoke about Adam, as you'll see. He gave the stages, but he didn't give them one after the other. He talks a little bit here, there, and different stages. And it is upon us to use our brain to figure out which stage was first. Allah doesn't want to do the job for us, like this is stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, no. At one point he mentions tayin, the mud, another one is a smelly darkened clay, another one is a pottery, and it's entirely up to us to figure out that thing, and alhamdulillah our scholars have. So at one point we were nothing, and that moment there we were dead, we were non-existent. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a grip of the land. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَكَانَ مِنْهُ الْأَحْمَرُ, there was the red, the white, and the black. So these are the main colors of the land. The main colors of the land, that is the red land, the white land, and the black land. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَبَيْنَ ذَلِكَ, i.e. And from these three colors originated different others, like brown, orange, and that's why we say these are the earth colors. And also Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pinpointed something, وَالسَّهْلُ وَالْحَزْنُ وَالْخَبِيثُ وَالطَّيِّبُ. Just because the earth, there is an easy earth, you'll find some people who have been created from an easy land, they are easy in their organic way, how Allah created them. Some others, they are miserable, because the land that they were created is of that miserable structure. And al-khabith, the nasty one, some land is just nasty, and other one is beautiful, pure land. So some of the land you plant in it doesn't give you anything. Another one you plant in it and it gives you abundantly. And that's just how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the land. So there you are, the first one, we were nothing. Then there was land and water. They were mixed up together and we became mud. Stage number 2, al-hama' al-masnoon. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ مِنْ حَمَئٍ مَسْنُونَ. Al-hama' al-masnoon is the smelly dark clay. And it starts drying up, at one point it starts getting smelly from that. So one of our stages is at one point we are nothing, then we are just land, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mixed to us water, and then we became mud, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let us dry for a time. Only Allah knows what is the length of time that we stayed in that stage. Stage number 3, صَلْصَالٍ كَالْفَخَّارِ خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ كَالْفَخَّارِ Surah Ar-Rahman, ayah 14. So after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala molded us into the shape that we are today. The head, the arms, and things like that. But we were empty from inside, just like a pottery. So at one point of our creation, we were nothing, then land mixed with water, and then we became mud, then we became a black turned mud, between very wet and getting to dry, and then after that we became pottery, and that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fashioned us. Number 4 is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was about to inject, blow a ruh in us. إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِنْ طِينٍ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember when Allah said to Rabbuk, your Rabb, said unto the Malaika, I am going to create a bashar, a human being, from a tin, mud. فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ تَسْوِيَ. Sawa in Arabic is very hard to find an equivalent name in English. But a taswiya means when I have fashioned, proportioned, and perfected him. At that moment there, وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. And نَفَخَ is to blow, inject, and endow him with my ruh. My here does not mean, وَلَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, that we are part of the soul of Allah. Astaghfirullah, this is not befit to say these things. But my ruh here is a ruh that Allah has specifically created for Adam alayhi as-salam. So that ruh is specifically created for Adam alayhi as-salam. And that ruh, it could be called a soul, a spirit, life. فَقَعُوا, the harf فَهِيَ means immediacy. Straight away, fall down to him in prostrations. At that moment there, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala injected the ruh in Adam alayhi salam, and Adam alayhi salam woke up, he saw all the angels prostrating to Adam alayhi salam. There is something here, and I'm sure you didn't know that, but it's worth knowing. When it comes to the soul, only humans have soul. Only humans have a soul. It means that horses do not have a soul. Animals do not have a soul. The angels do not have a soul. The devil, the shayateen, the jinn do not have a soul. The only one that has a soul is mankind. This is why if we kill a horse, you don't go to jail for killing a horse. And you don't go to jail if you kill an elephant. But if you kill a human being, you go to jail, because the soul is a specific gift given by Allah to mankind. I repeat, animals do not have a soul. They have life in them. Allah endowed them with a life, just like He endowed al-Malaika with a life, and just like He endowed al-Jinn with a life. But these, the other creatures, except a human being, nobody else has a soul. Now, why did Iblis refuse to prostrate to our father Adam alayhi salam? Here is why. Iblis, it was not an issue like, oh, I don't want to the face of Adam alayhi salam, that's it, I'm not going to prostrate to them. No, there is more to it. Iblis lived with al-Malaika for so long in heaven. Al-Malaika never ever told Iblis anything special about his creation. So Iblis, when Allah started fashioning our father Adam, as in Tafsir ibn Kathir and many other books of the, I will get to that anyway inshallah on time, when Iblis started seeing Allah fashioning Adam and designing him and sculpting him and giving him the way we are today, Iblis started asking questions. What is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is this creature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is creating? At the beginning, Iblis didn't see much about what was going on. Until the third stage, when Allah made us like a pottery, 60 arm length, lying down, fashioned the head and everything, and we had orifices like the nostrils, the mouth, the ears, and all these holes that we have in the body. Iblis would walk inside our father Adam, and he used to wonder. He said, what is this? Why is it so special about him? The why? And then at that moment there, Iblis got jealous. I was created simply from fire. Nothing big. It's not like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told al-Malaik, I'm going to create al-Jinn, and then the creation of al-Jinn went through phases. No, the creation of al-Jinn was just pure fire, as we will see in details later. But the creation of us humans, of our father Adam alayhi salam and us by fellowship, was a special event. And Iblis got jealous as to why does Allah give such a privilege to Adam? Why didn't Allah prostrate the angels to me? Why is he making us prostrate to this creature? Because the shaitan didn't hear much about his own creation, it was nothing special. So it was what it is that makes him different than I. Oh no, if my creation was not special, then his creation shouldn't be special. So Iblis was, he built up throughout all the time that he was in the heavens based on what he saw from Adam alayhi salam, and also when he heard that there was a special ceremony that Allah summoned everybody in the heavens to attend, and that ceremony was the prostrations of to Adam alayhi salam when Allah gives him life. So Iblis, the shaitan, had plenty time. He had plenty time to conjure up his plan. That's why when Allah asked him questions in Al-Quran, Why don't you prostrate? Why don't you obey? Iblis had the answers ready because he worked on them for all that time. And Allah knew exactly what Iblis was on about. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his infinite wisdom, did not want to reveal that. So here you understand, my brothers and my sisters, that the animosity of a shaitan is not based on just a mere thought. At that moment, he decided, oh no. He planned and pre-planned and rehearsed it in his mind and he rehearsed it in his heart. And he created scenarios. If this happens, I'll do that. If that happens, I do this. If those things happen, I'll do that. But at the end of it, he said, no matter who this person was, I will not bow down to him. And that's exactly what happened. Just like our father Adam alayhi salam is the father of creation of mankind, Ash-Shaytan, Iblis, is the father of the jinn. Iblis is the father of al-jinn. And he, just like Adam alayhi salam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a female devil for him, and that's how his offspring, he got it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Kahf, ayah number 50, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس كان من الجن ففسق عن أمر ربه أفتتخذونه وذريته أولياء من دوني وهم لكم عدو. And recall when we said to the angels, prostrate to Adam, immediately they obliged. But Iblis, who was of the jinn, disobeyed and passed over the limits of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and didn't obey Allah. And then Allah says to us, do you take him and his progeny as awliya, meaning the first ones to call upon in case of trouble and things like that? What an evil substitute for the wrongdoers. So Allah says here, Iblis and his offspring. So Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah and the scholars of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah believe that Iblis is the father of al-jinn. So here my brothers and my sisters, I want to keep this to a half an hour mark. So here my brothers and my sisters, you can see now that the animosity of Iblis is a long trailed journey. He did it and he objected at the time of the creation, at the time of the prostrations, and the fight still goes on. In the next talk, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, I will start talking about who they are. Today, we covered what Iblis is, being the father, and we spoke about the creation of our father, Adam. To understand the other questions, do jinn possess us, and do they have control on all these things, we need to understand the whole concept of the jinn and the shaitan, and we go through all the Qur'an, and inshallah, by the end of this talk, you'll be all well done and informed. Allah knows more. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. And until the next part 2 of Al-Jinn, stay in the mercy of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.